So today we will do the opposite process. Yesterday we did synthesis and today we will do fatty acid oxidation. So these two process, synthesis and oxidation, they are completely opposite process. They are completely opposite process. Now in synthesis, if you can compare fatty acid synthesis, what did you see? You saw synthesis of fatty acid from acetyl coenzyme. Fatty acid, which fatty acid? Palmitic acid. And higher fatty acid will be synthesized by chain elongation enzyme. Fatty acid that is present in endoplasmic reticulum. So palmitic acid will be synthesized in fatty acid synthesis. This whole process happens in well-fed condition. So what is this fatty acid oxidation? What should be there in fatty acid oxidation? So what do you expect in fatty acid oxidation?
Does it occurs in fasting condition?
It occurs in fasting condition, good. Fasting, starvation, and then what else?
Breakdown. So it is basically the breakdown of fatty acids.
To what?
It is like breakdown of fatty acid.
Breakdown of fatty acid to what?
So acetyl CoA.
Acetyl CoA. And then this here you have seen what is happening here, NADPH is being utilized. So 2-NADPH is being utilized, you have seen. So how many NADPH equivalent molecules should be produced here? Each bond formation required 2 NADH. Each bond, 7 bonds formation is there. So I am not talking about that 7. Okay, 7 times is there, but each reaction, each conversion require 2 NADPH. So how many per bond? How many?
2.
This 2 will be produced. Okay. So here you will see 1 NAD+, and then second is FAD. So here 2 molecule is produced as 1 NAD plus 1 NADH plus 1 FADH, DH2. Here is also 7 steps are there. You will see 7 steps here also. So total will be 7. Total will be what? 7 NADH and 7 FADH2. Total production of reducing equivalent from this fatty acid oxidation, there will be 7 NADH and 7, if you see 7 NADH and 7 FADH2, here 7 to the 14 NADPH will be consumed. Here reduction, you can see here reduction is, here is reduction, and here you will see oxidation. So synthesis you will see reduction, and then breakdown you see oxidation. And then site, this is condition. This is the answer to the question, when does it happen? When does it happen? So this is the answer to this question. So how, what does happen? These are the answer to what happens actually. So what question is answered by this? What happens? So this happens, reduction will produce this palmitic acid. If 7 times reduction, utilizing 2 NADPH produce fatty acid. And then here, Here polymerization, essentially here polymerization, here breakdown. So it is catabolism, it is anabolism. Now where? Let's answer where question. Where does this happen, this process? Tell me.
In the mitochondrial matrix, maybe.
Where? Which process happens in where? Synthesis happens where? First tell me, synthesis happens where?
Synthesis happens in the matrix of the mitochondria.
Synthesis happens in matrix of mitochondria? The whole hour, whole 1 hour actually, if you speak like this, I will feel like my whole hour of yesterday was wasted. Tell me, where is synthesis? Fatty acid synthesis happens where?
Cytosol.
Yes, cytosol. And elongation of fatty acid synthesis, fatty acid elongation in endoplasmic reticulum. 16 carbon compound palmitic acid will be synthesized and it will be elongated further by endoplasmic reticulum enzyme. So this is the site where synthesis happens. Now where does this oxidation happens?
In the matrix, structural matrix.
Yes, matrix of mitochondria. Matrix of mitochondria. Where oxygen is very high. So oxidation will happen at the place where oxygen is very high. So now tell me why. Let's answer one last question. Why does this pathway happen? So what is the purpose of this fatty acid synthesis and what is the purpose of this fatty acid oxidation? Why? Answer the why question. I am asking the why question. Why does this fatty acid synthesis happens? What is the purpose? Why does this fatty acid oxidation happen?
Fatty acid synthesis happens because we are in well-fed condition and our body doesn't need more food or glucose, so it stores in the form
excess,
of fatty acids.
Yes. Storage of excess energy. You can call storage of excess energy. Okay. Do you mean the same thing what I am writing?
Yes, sir.
Excess energy. Okay. So storage of excess energy. Now you'll see during fat. What is fatty acid oxidation purpose?
Because we are in a fasting condition and we need energy. So the excess energy stored is used there.
Yeah. Stored energy is spent during adverse condition. We actually save money for rainy days. Here, this is rainy days. So adverse condition. So what happens is this stored fatty acid is consumed. This is a fuel, basically a fuel. During fatty oxidation provides, it is a fuel, it is oxidation of fuel. Fatty acid is fuel for fasting condition, fasting and starvation. So this is the main purpose. So oxidation of fatty acid provides energy during fasting and starvation condition. And this fed condition, this energy, excess energy that we eat, which cannot be utilized right during fed condition, will be stored in the form of fatty acid. Did you get the context, the whole thing about this fatty acid synthesis and fatty acid breakdown? Did you understand?
Yes, sir.
So can we move?
Yes, sir.
So if you understood this much, this is what we are going to describe. In whole topic, we are going to describe about this. If you understand, see, always the context is very important. If you understand the context, you will never forget things. Okay? You will never forget the foundation thing. Basic things you will never forget. But if you don't understand context, you will forget basic thing. If you forget basic things, other things what you remember will not have that much value. So try to always understand this context. The context of fasting condition and context of heat condition. So which hormone do you expect here to be predominant during fatty acid synthesis? One more question. Which hormone will, under the influence of which hormone all this event happens?
Acetyl coenzyme carboxylase.
It is enzyme, rate limiting enzyme of this. Acetyl coenzyme is not hormone, okay? It is, okay, hormone will regulate this enzyme. That is different. Yes?
Insulin.
Yeah, insulin is hormone, okay? Insulin. Insulin. It is enzyme, these all things are happening inside the cell. So enzyme will present in cell. This insulin will be in blood. And then during fasting and starvation condition, which hormone dominate the whole condition? Will stimulate all the reaction?
Glucagon.
Good. So here now in this condition is controlled by insulin. This condition is controlled by glucagon. So this is the most master, you can see the big point. Very important point for regulation is understanding of the hormone. Which hormone regulates what? So if you understand which hormone regulates, you understand regulation. Now let's start today's topic. So you can see, you already now know when does fatty acid oxidation happens. Why does it happen? You know. Where does it happen? You also know this. Then what happens? So we will talk about this rate limiting steps. So what question, whenever we talk about what question, we answer three what. What means what is enzyme? Enzyme means rate limiting steps. What are enzymes, important enzymes? What are coenzymes? Coenzymes means vitamins and minerals that is associated with the enzyme. So coenzymes. And then third question we ask is, what are the substrate and product? Substrate product. So three questions are related to what question? So I want you to ask this five question about all pathways. If you ask this five question, this is fundamental questions. If you ask about the pathway, you will understand the fundamental. You will actually memorize the fundamental. If you are able to answer this five question, then you will understand. If you make your notes based on this five question of any pathway, then that note will cover your 80% of the important thing automatically. So remember that. Now, so you already know, I don't have to say that glucagon activate fatty acid oxidation. You know this now. By now, you know glucagon regulates. So what is the purpose of this? So you already know, it is a source of energy during fasting. You already know, you have answered this question. So the main substrate for energy production in liver, cardiac muscle. So muscle, cardiac muscle and skeletal muscle, liver and renal, peripheral tissues, except brain RBC, these tissues, except this tissue, brain RBC, renal medulla, lens, this all tissue, your cornea, lens, your cornea, this all tissue, except this tissue, all peripheral tissue, majority tissue, you know, 60% of our body weight is muscle, and heart, and smooth muscle, this all tissue will utilize fatty acid during fasting or starvation condition. The glucose will be spared for brain and this tissue. So remember, this is very important fuel fast fatty acid is a very important fuel during fat fasting and starvation condition. Now, after you know this, so what question I told you, what are the enzymes, coenzymes are required for the synthesis of oxidation of fatty acid? You can see these are the enzyme coenzymes. So these are, you can see NAD, I told you one NADH is produced, one FADH is produced, H2 is produced. As we have seen, two NADPH is utilized. NADPH is utilized in fatty acid synthesis. The opposite is for production. Here in fatty acid synthesis utilization, here one NADH, one FADH2 will be produced. So NA means niacin and FADH means riboflavin. So vitamin B2 and vitamin B3 are involved. Vitamin B3 and vitamin B2 are involved. You can see pantothenic coenzyme. What is coenzyme A? Coenzyme A is pantothenic acid. So fatty acid obviously is a reactant. So fatty acid will be reactant. Now, carnitine is a very special molecule that you will see. We will talk about this carnitine. Carnitine is very important for transportation of this fatty acid from outside of the cell to, from the actually cytosol to mitochondria. It actually helps, this carnitine helps transport of fatty acid to mitochondrial matrix. So we will talk about this carnitine also. This is very important molecule. Then ATP. So ATP is required in the start of the reaction, but in when reaction ends, so there will be more production of ATP. As we have seen also glycolysis. Isn't there consumption of 2 ATP in the beginning? In the glycolysis? Haven't you seen utilization of 2 ATP in the beginning in glycolysis?
Yes, sir.
The same way, here ATP, 2 ATP will be utilized in the beginning. Then there will be ATP production in the form of this. This will ultimately convert into ATP. This will also convert into ATP. Now this all event, as I have told you, mitochondria, it happens in mitochondria of almost all nucleated cells. But brain cell does not directly metabolize this fatty acid because this fatty acid generally does not cross the blood-brain barrier. So this fatty acid oxidation does not happen in brain. Rather, ketone body, this fatty acid will convert into ketone body in brain, in liver, sorry, ketone body will be produced in liver, and this ketone body will be utilized by brain. So we will talk about ketone body synthesis after we finish beta oxidation. So you have already understood the context, where does it happen, how does it happen, when does it happen, and then what happens. You have already understood the major question of any pathway. You have already answered many questions of the pathway. Let's begin with the fatty acid oxidation. In fatty acid oxidation, there are actually minor pathways. Okay, minor pathway, because through this pathway, very few amount of fatty acid will be oxidized. And there is second pathway, is major pathway. So we will talk about minor pathway here only. And then we will talk about major pathway after this. So these are three, there are three minor pathways. You can remember alpha, beta, and omega. Three types of minor pathways are there. Two happens in peroxisome and one in endoplasmic reticulum. So peroxisome inside cell, there are 100 to 1000 peroxisome in one cell. So this peroxisome are the center for oxidation of fatty acid. Few fatty acid, not all fatty acid, there are a specific fatty acid. Oxidation of that fatty acid happens in peroxisome. So in peroxisome, beta oxidation happens. Oxidation happens in peroxisome for very long chain fatty acid. I will tell you what is very long chain fatty acid. Just wait for a moment. Just remember for the time being, very long chain fatty acid. Maybe it is very long chain fatty acid you can take. It has more than 20 carbon fatty acid. So very long chain fatty acid will be oxidized by peroxisome. that is present inside cell, not in mitochondria. And this very long chain fatty acid will convert into, in peroxisome, it converts into medium chain fatty acid. And this medium chain fatty acid will be oxidized by mitochondria. See, this whole event I am describing that is happening inside the cell. So this, after conversion of this very long chain fatty acid into 8 carbon medium chain, see, this fatty acid will be oxidized by this mitochondria. Now you know this. If mitochondria is not there, this very long chain fatty acid will also not be completely oxidized. So very beta oxidation of very long chain fatty acid happens in peroxisome. What, number one point. Second number point, alpha oxidation. So alpha oxidation, there is one very important type of fatty acid. This fatty acid is branch chain fatty acid. Okay. This fatty acid is branch chain, 20 carbon branch chain fatty acid. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So two are extra here. You can see. Two has been extra. 17, 18, 19, 20. So six, you can see here, 20 carbon branch chain fatty acid. This is called phytenic acid. Phytenic acid. This is alpha oxidation. This phytenic acid, first this carbon, this is alpha carbon. So it will be oxidized. Then after oxidation of through this, this is called alpha oxidation. After oxidation of alpha oxidation, this molecule will undergo beta oxidation, peroxisomal beta oxidation. This molecule, peroxisomal beta oxidation. So this particular phytenic acid, for this phytenic acid, alpha oxidation is reserved only for this phytenic acid. So this is alpha oxidation that happens in this peroxisome, and beta oxidation also happens in peroxisome, but for very long chain fatty acid, not for long chain fatty acid. Very long chain fatty acids, beta oxidation happens in peroxisome. So we have seen alpha oxidation, beta oxidation, and this omega oxidation. This omega oxidation, omega means this carbon. Last carbon. This is omega carbon. So omega oxidation happens to this carbon. This happens in endoplasmic reticulum. These are very minor type of pathway. And what is the source of phytenic acid? Source of phytenic acid is dairy product. Dairy product and meat of ruminants. Goat meat, lamb meat, beef, these have this phytenic acid because these are ruminant, and actually this animal also get phytenic acid from chlorophyll, metabolism of chlorophyll. So from chlorophyll they produce phytenic acid. And phytonic acid has to be metabolized. And metabolism of phytonic acid occurs in peroxisome through alpha oxidation. So remember, phytonic acid, this is very important condition. Because if this alpha oxidation is absent, this will cause a disease called Refsum disease. This is a neurological disease. Refsum disease is a neurological disease. So this will cause neurometabolic disease. This is called neurometabolic disease, and because of this, neurological disease will happen. So did you all understand three types of minor oxidation?
Yeah.
So remember the name: peroxisomal beta and peroxisomal alpha, and then omega oxidation that happens in endoplasmic reticulum. This is for phytenic acid. You know phytenic acid, where do we get phytenic acid from? And very long chain fatty acid is the fatty acid that has more than 20 carbon compound fatty acid. So these are the compound used. So we will now describe the whole process of beta oxidation, right from the lipolysis to beta oxidation. We will do whole process. We will understand the whole process. Then we will understand the individual beta oxidation. What is whole process? So first, you know, when you are in fasting condition, what is the source of your fat? Lipid that is being oxidized. Source of lipid is adipose tissue. And from this adipose tissue, what is present in adipose tissue? Can anybody tell me? What is there in adipose tissue? Fat is stored in adipose tissue in which form? In adipose tissue, I have already described you, I have already taught you. In adipose tissue, fat is stored in which form? And I have already given you a pathway for synthesis of that lipid also. So in adipose tissue, what type of lipid is stored?
We have triglycerides.
Yes, triacylglycerol. Triacylglycerol. Yes, triacylglycerol. So this is triacylglycerol is present in adipose tissue. Now this triacylglycerol will have to be will break down into what? During fasting condition has to be broken down into what? Fatty acid plus?
Glycerol.
So, and this breakdown will be done by some lipase. Okay? You can see, this will be broken down to fatty acid and glycerol, and it should be done by this breakdown of this ester bond should be done by some lipase. This is a different type of lipase that is activated by hormone glucagon, and that is why this is called hormone sensitive lipase. So this whole event is happening inside the cell of adipocyte. So this is glucagon is present outside. These events are happening inside the cell of adipocytes. So glucagon will bind with its receptor and then it will activate CAMP. This high CAMP will activate this enzyme that is present inside adipocyte, and this enzyme will break down this triglyceride that is present in adipose tissue to fatty acid and glycerol. Did you get this? So did you get this? If you get this now, this is the event that is happening in adipocyte. This is the event that is happening in adipocyte. So what will happen after this triacylglycerol will break down? It will come into this, say, this very triglyceride will come into what? Blood. From adipose tissue, it will come into blood. From blood, it will reach tissue. Which tissue? Peripheral tissue. For example, muscle, liver, and cardiac muscle. So this fatty acid will be bonded to, actually they will bind to albumin, and they will reach this tissue. Now at this tissue, so this fatty acid will be activated inside the tissue. This fatty acid activated means this fatty acid will convert inside the tissue. After it traveled through the blood, after it reaches the tissue, inside the cell of the tissue. So this fatty acid will convert into, by an enzyme, it will convert into acyl coenzyme A. Okay? Fatty acid will convert into acyl coenzyme A. This is an activation of fatty acid. Now you can see at the activation step, this is the first step is lipolysis, second step is activation. Now you can see activation requires ATP. So activation requires two high energy phosphate, and this two high energy phosphate is equivalent to two ATP. So you can see this ATP being converted into AMP and utilization of two high energy phosphate, that means two ATP here is being utilized. So you, after utilization of 2 ATP, this fatty acid is activated, and now activated fatty acid that is there inside the cell, this is event that is happening inside the cell. Okay, so this cell, this is mitochondria. Imagine this is mitochondria. Now this fatty acid, acyl coenzyme, will cross this mitochondrial membrane. Will have to enter into mitochondrial membrane. Now I will tell you, when I tell you fatty acyl coenzyme, just remember long chain fatty acyl coenzyme. I am talking about long chain fatty acid. This is long chain fatty acid. Which long chain? Specifically, be specific for palmitic acid. Okay. Remember that I am talking about palmitic acid. So this long chain fatty acid can will enter into mitochondria like this. So acyl coenzyme A will enter into mitochondria, but acyl coenzyme A cannot cross mitochondria as acyl coenzyme A. This acyl coenzyme A has to disguise itself. Acyl coenzyme A will have to disguise itself. How does it disguise? The carnitine is the molecule that actually disguises this. So what happens is this acyl coenzyme A will convert into, so obviously after it enters, it will go under beta oxidation. So first let's talk about how acyl coenzyme A enters through into mitochondria and becomes again as acyl coenzyme A. So disguise step. So first it will be disguised. So this acyl coenzyme A will convert, disguise itself into acyl carnitine. So here carnitine molecule will bind to this carnitine, and this coenzyme A will be removed from this acyl. So acyl carnitine now can enter into the mitochondria easily as acyl carnitine. Now acyl carnitine, once it's reached into mitochondria, then acyl carnitine will change its shed, its disguise, and again convert into acetyl coenzyme A. And this acetyl coenzyme A undergo beta oxidation and will produce this one FADH, one NADH per bond breakage per acetyl coenzyme A. You can see here the conversion of this acetyl coenzyme A into this will be done by one enzyme here. And this again, this acyl carnitine again will be converted by this acetyl coenzyme A by similar this second enzyme. So this enzyme is called carnitine palmitoyl transferase, in short CPT1. You can see here CPT1. So this enzyme convert acyl coenzyme A into acyl carnitine. And then same type of enzyme here. This enzyme's name is again carnitine palmitoyl transferase. But this is 2. That is why CPT2. This CPT2 converts this acyl carnitine back to acyl coenzyme A. This converts acyl coenzyme into acyl carnitine. Now, did you get this? Did you understand this? How acyl coenzyme A,
yes, sir,
enters this mitochondria. Now, there is this third enzyme that actually present in the membrane. This all three enzymes are present in this. This is CPT2. All three enzymes are present in the mitochondrial membrane. I will tell you about detail where does this present. So this CPT1 is present in outer mitochondrial. These two are present in inner mitochondrial membrane. Now there is third enzyme. This is called carnitine acyl carnitine translocase. This is translocase. So this translocase transfer this acyl carnitine from outside of the membrane to inside the membrane, mitochondrial matrix. So this three enzyme, if you see these three enzymes, CPT1, CPT2, and CAT, these three enzymes work coordinately to transport this acyl coenzyme A into mitochondrial matrix. Did you get this?
So what did you say about CAT?
This is CAT. The full form of CAT is carnitine. This is nothing but a channel. You can assume it's a channel for through which this acyl carnitine enter. And this is actually called translocage, not transferage. Translocage. This translocate acyl carnitine from outside of the membrane to inside the membrane into the mitochondrial matrix. Carnitine, acyl carnitine. This full form is CAT, full form of CAT is carnitine, acyl carnitine. Translocage. This is translocate. So did you understand this three enzyme?
Yes, enzymes
are required for transporting this acetyl coenzyme A into mitochondrial matrix. So this is a very important step. The transportation of fatty acid is the most important step, more important than beta oxidation itself, because it is regulated. This step is regulated. And you know, and this is also because hormone comes here, and that is why this step is also regulated. So these two steps are regulated. First is breakdown of this lipid into fatty acid and glycerol. This is first step is regulated. This step lipolysis is regulated by glucagon and insulin. Insulin inhibit, okay, glucagon stimulate lipolysis, insulin inhibit lipolysis. And then this step. So this step will also be regulated. During fed condition, this channel will be shut down. During fed condition, what happens? Lipid, fatty acid synthesis. So what is the rate limiting step for fatty acid synthesis? Rate limiting step of fatty acid synthesis, tell me. So what is the function of this acetyl coenzyme and carboxylase?
It converts malonyl.
Converts acetyl coenzyme A into sticky acetyl coenzyme A. What is that sticky acetyl coenzyme A?
Malonyl
coenzyme A. So this malonyl coenzyme A, this happens during fed condition. And this malonyl coenzyme A actually inhibit this enzyme, the PT1, okay? And that is why during fed condition, this fatty acid cannot be transported. But on the opposite end, during fasting condition, this is not there, this is not active, and this is not there. So this will not be activated. This will not be inhibited. And that is how during fasting condition, because of influence of glucagon, and because malonyl coenzyme is not there, this fatty acid can easily enter into mitochondria. Did you all get this? So I actually explained everything in one slide. The whole process of fatty acid oxidation right from lipolysis to beta oxidation, okay? I have not told you in detail of this beta oxidation, but I told you whole process. What happens during fasting condition? How? What happens? What are the processes that happens? And how that processes are regulated? I also told you about regulation. So here you can see, I have written the number. Four steps are there. So this four step you can remember yourself. So this whole process goes through four steps. First is lipolysis, second is activation of fatty acid, and third is mitochondrial transport, and fourth is beta oxidation. And which two steps are regulated here? You know, among these four steps, which are regulated? First, and this?
Lipolysis and mitochondrial transport.
These two steps are regulated. So this is regulated by which molecule? transport malonyl coenzyme A inhibit transport during fed condition, and in fasting condition malonyl coenzyme is not there, not inhibited. So let's see this. Let's classify this fatty acids. So I told you palmitic acid. From the beginning, I am telling you palmitic acid. Palmitic acid is a long chain fatty acid. Palmitic acid. So long, it is a long chain fatty acid. We are more concerned about this palmitic acid because predominant fatty acid of our body is palmitic acid, and second is stearic acid. Two carbon more, stearic acid. So all fatty acid that is present in adipocytes, they are either 16 carbon or 18 carbon. So we are more concerned about long chain fatty acid. So that is why this transportation is required. Only long chain fatty acid will be transported through this carnitine shuttle. This is called carnitine shuttle. So transport through this carnitine, binding with carnitine shuttle. Only long chain fatty acid will be transported through. Short chain fatty acid does not require this shuttle. Short chain and medium chain, they don't require this carnitine shuttle. Only long chain will require. And you know this very long chain fatty acid will be metabolized in peroxisome first. So we cannot talk about this very long chain. And in very long chain fatty acid directly enter into peroxisome. Now, this fatty acid, long chain fatty acid, is a fatty acid between 12 to. So you can call it, because it is odd number, 14 carbon to 20 carbon is the long chain fatty acid. Okay, now you can see this two fall under. If you remember these two fatty acid as long chain, you can remember long chain fatty acid. And short medium chain is 6 to 12. Long chain is, I told you, above 20. So you can remember easily, long, very long chain fatty acid, above 20. So these are the classification of fatty acid based on number of chain. So less than 5 is short chain fatty acid. And I told you, where is this short chain fatty acid present? In butter. So butter has short chain fatty acid. Butter, fatty acid of butter does not require carnitine for transportation. And fatty, where does medium chain fatty acid is present? Milk. It also present in milk. Short chain and medium chain are present in milk, goat milk and other milk. And they don't require carnitine. Also, they are present in coconut oil. So this oil, they don't require carnitine. Now this require carnitine. Animal fat require carnitine. And this actually will be metabolized in peroxisome. Now let's see this. So we have talked about this four step. We will describe this four step one. So we will describe this four step one. What is the time now? 5 minutes are left. Okay. We will do many things because we have already done a whole pathway. So we can go, you can understand everything. Now, lipolysis we have done. A lipolysis, which enzyme is required for lipolysis? Tell me, answer me. Which enzyme is required for lipolysis? This is very important enzyme.
Hormone sensitive lipase.
Okay. Yes, it will be done by lipase. And this lipase is hormone sensitive. Always lipolysis will be done by lipase. It is easy. Wherever you see lipolysis, it will be done by lipase. It's easy to remember enzyme. And here, the lipase is hormone sensitive. It will be activated by glucagon and inhibited by insulin. That is why sensitive to glucagon and insulin. And this is why this is called hormone sensitive lipase. So it does lipolysis. This is very important step. Now, second, we will talk about second step. So we have already done this first step. We'll do second step. You can see, you already understand. You can understand. So fatty acid will bind with this ATP, and 2-phosphate will be utilized. It will convert fatty acyl coenzyme. It will be converted into fatty acyl coenzyme. The enzyme here is fatty acyl coenzyme A synthetase. This is synthetase. Synthetase means require energy. Synthase does not require energy. There is difference between synthase and synthetase. When we call synthase, no ATP utilization. When we call it synthetase, there is ATP utilization. You can see ATP utilization, that is why it is called synthetase. And also called, because ATP is being utilized And this coenzyme A is added, high energy molecule coenzyme A is added. That is why it is also called kinase, thiokinase. So this is sulfur containing compound is added to fatty acid. This is also called thiokinase or acyl coenzyme A synthetase or acyl coenzyme A thiokinase. Both are the same thing. Acyl coenzyme A thiokinase and acyl coenzyme A synthetase. So this enzyme is this. And this enzyme is sensitive to only long chain fatty acid. Remember, this enzyme is active for long chain fatty acid. Okay, this enzyme has activity for long chain fatty acid, not for short chain fatty acid or very long chain fatty acid. There is no activity. So body has designed the way to channel only long chain fatty acid that is very high in our body for metabolism. Short chain fatty acid actually easily cross the mitochondria, it will be metabolized easily. And long chain, very long chain fatty acid will not be actually converted into acetyl coenzyme by this enzyme. It will enter into peroxisome. Different enzyme will be utilized for that. So now see this, this is transport. So for transportation, what do we require? We require carnitine. Carnitine is nothing but butyric acid. Butyric acid means 4 carbon acid. This 1, 2, 3, 4 carbon butyric acid. And butyric, which type of butyric acid? Amino butyric acid. And which amino? Quaternary amino. Quaternary amino butyric acid. You can see this is quaternary amino trimethyl amino group is there. This is butyric acid. With this butyric acid, there is hydroxy group. So hydroxy group and amine group makes this butyric acid very soluble, very much soluble. And that is why this solubility is required for transportation of very long chain fatty acid from cytosol to mitochondria. This helps that fatty acid to translocate. And this enzyme is there, CAT, will bind to this carnitine, will bind to this carnitine and put that with carnitine containing fatty acid into the mitochondrial matrix. So this is how carnitine is helping the transportation. This is called carnitine shuttle. And we have already described carnitine shuttle. This requires three enzymes. One is CPT1, other is CPT. The second enzyme that will act is CAT, and then third is CPT2. Sequence is this. First CPT1 will act, then CAT, and then CPT2. So these are the sequence. You can see activated fatty acid. This. Now where do we get carnitine? Carnitine we will get in meat product, and our body has also capacity to synthesize carnitine from amino acid lysine. Okay? And lysine and methionine will be utilized. This methyl group that you see, it is derived from, if you remember, S-adenosylmethionine. Do you remember S-adenosylmethionine? It is an active methyl donor. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Yes, this methyl group come from SAM. And this is part of lysine. So this lysine and methionine will form carnitine in our body. So you can see this transport. We will do this and then we will finish this. So you already know, first enzyme is CPT1, second enzyme is CAT, and then third enzyme is CPT2. And this acyl coenzyme A synthetase, it is also present in outer mitochondrial membrane that converts fatty acid into acyl coenzyme A, also in endoplasmic reticulum. Both places it is present. And it is always bound to the membrane, not present in cytosol. So you can see this will activate, and activated acetyl coenzyme A can pass this outer mitochondrial membrane, but not inner mitochondrial membrane. So on outer mitochondrial, this acyl coenzyme A will be converted into acyl carnitine. This acyl carnitine can be taken by this CAT and will be put this CAT, throw this CAT into mitochondrial matrix. Now this acyl carnitine in mitochondrial matrix again will convert into acyl coenzyme A. So now you can easily understand this concept. Otherwise, it seems very difficult. This process seems very difficult. Now you understand this process. So you can see acetyl convert into acyl, here convert into acyl carnitine again convert into acyl. Now beta oxidation will happen. Did you understand this carnitine shuttle, this third process?
Yes, sir.
So, and this is regulated step. CPT1 is regulated step by malonyl coenzyme. So, with this, we finish our class today here. So, we will talk about beta oxidation another next class.